Good evening. Lights are bright. Each year, the Joint Center for Political and Economic Studies bestows the Lewis E. Martin Great American Award for someone that is an exemplar of change, progress, and coalition building across racial lines. The pantheon of individuals that have been received this award include past presidents Carter and Clinton, Congressman Rangel and Clyburn, Muhammad Ali, Dr. Dorothy Height, Jesse Jackson, and most recently, the Honorable Lewis, Congressman Lewis from Atlanta. This year, we're recognizing another leader from Atlanta. He's also a proud graduate of Howard University in Washington, D.C. He represents a new generation of leaders, skilled, innovative, pragmatic, but also he's determined to do what's right for the people and to focus on ensuring that everyone has an opportunity for a good quality of life. Since his inauguration 2 years ago, Mayor Kasim Reed has won national acclaim for his bold leadership during the toughest times of America's largest cities. He's getting results. And he's setting a new standard for bold leadership and excellence in leadership. So let's watch the video.
A son of Howard, the visionary voice of a new generation of political leaders, Mayor Kasim Reed has been aggressive and strategic in balancing the city of Atlanta's troublesome budget.
Where are you worried still as a supporter of the president as he gets closer to a general election?
What I'm worried about is what we don't know. He's got to let the American public know that he's doing every single thing he can, because folks will likely feel a pinch around the gas costs, gas prices. He's also got to have a conversation about his grand bargain. Mm-hmm. In order to keep independence, he's got to continue to talk about his efforts to reduce the debt and deficit. He's got to get out in front of that right now.
By limiting the pension funds of full-time city workers, Mayor Reed was able to provide more police on the streets of Atlanta and additional funding to community centers in lower-income neighborhoods around the city. A former Georgia state representative, state senator, and international corporate lawyer, Mayor Reed spent his early college years perfecting the art of the political deal. As a senior undergraduate trustee on the Howard University Board of Trustees, he instituted a $15 student fee increase that would be matched dollar for dollar. Today, that federal fundraising program called the Independence Initiative has added over $10 million to the Howard University Endowment Fund.
We are moving from new to next and from better to best. That's why when Kamala Harris campaigned to become the first female attorney general of California, I was campaigning right with her by her side. The founders of the university smile, and we're not a museum. We're making it happen and hot right now. I'm just here for you to use me. And I'm talking about the students who are at Howard University. You don't have to reach back so far. You can tell them about the guy in Atlanta. I'm a double Howard grad, so you can't get around me. Nobody can take the credit for what happened to me but Howard University.
By 2002, Mayor Reed had become the youngest general trustee to be appointed to the Howard University Board of Trustees, where he continues to serve as an active member today. Born in Plainfield, New Jersey, and raised in Fulton County, Georgia, Mayor Reed received his bachelor's and law degrees from Howard University. He's a member of the American, National, and Georgia Bar Associations and a dedicated member of the Cascade United Methodist Church in Atlanta.
For more than four decades, the Joint Center has been about supporting, encouraging, and working with our nation's emerging leaders. We've always had an eye on history, on our legacy, and on our forebears, those who have blazed trails and opened doors for all who followed in their footsteps. But we've always kept our eyes firmly on the future, and on facilitating the passing of the torch from one generation of leaders to the next. Today, we have the future right here with us in Mayor Kasim Reed. His record of success, his efforts to bring everyone in his community together to solve their problems, and his innovative spirit in finding solutions that work, but also his determination to ensure that no one is left behind. These are the qualities that make Mayor Reed one of the most compelling leaders of his generation. It is an honor and a privilege to present this year's Louis E. Martin Great American Award to Mayor Kasim Reed.
I hope y'all will give me a moment just to take this in and say, wow. Chairwoman Marshall, President Everett, members of the governing board for the Joint Center, I'm so deeply grateful for this award. I'm just having to recover from the shock of my staff providing that shot of me in that high top fade. Somebody's job security is in doubt. I have to tell you all, that was really something. This is a really terrific night. You can feel incredible energy in the room. And I will tell you all, when I got the envelope with the letter, I've been a fan of the Joint Center for Political and Economic Studies for many years, because when I first got elected to the Georgia General Assembly, when I was about 28 years old, I got put on the mailing list for the Joint Center as a newly elected official, and they really do take you in and begin to educate you on a number of policy positions. But I remember being so proud when I began to get the letters from the Joint Center, and I used to read them, and it helped inform my thinking. So to go from that point in 1998 to being here today as the 59th mayor of the city of Atlanta is an important source of pride for me and the people of the city of Atlanta. So when I was in my office, and the letter from the Joint Center came in, and it said, you know, we would like you to win or to come and receive the Louis Miller Award, I mean, I immediately looked and saw some of the folks who've been honored, former presidents, and Muhammad Ali, who I love, and so many other extraordinary individuals, John Lewis, Presidential Medal of Freedom winner, so I was just kind of sitting there, and so I did what I do when I'm kind of stunned. I picked up the phone and I called my father, who's very grounded and very matter-of-fact, and I said, Dad, you know, I got this letter from the Joint Center. And I don't know if anybody's playing a joke on me, but they want me to get this award. And my dad said, well, first of all, son, you need to call him and tell him yes immediately in case it was a mistake. He said, right away. He said, then you need to write a letter of acceptance. And I'm like, y'all are stuck with me. I'm coming to get it. I'll be on time. But then I thought about the topic, really having connectivity to the next generation of leaders, and I thought that it showed great vision, not really because it is me in particular, but really to connect the Joint Center and its vital work to a younger generation, certainly a younger generation that believes in what I call sitting time. And in Atlanta, we call sitting time when you spend time around your elders who have had success, who have fought the fights, who have stood on the front lines of freedom, and who created the environment that got me where I am today, and just shut your mouth and listen and take it in. Now, I come from Atlanta, and we are very spoiled because we have so many extraordinary leaders from the civil rights and human rights movement who are around the city, and they live. Andrew Young lives about 9 minutes from my house, and Congressman Lewis lives about 5 minutes from my house, and Joseph E. Lowery lives about 8 minutes from my house, and they've all won the Presidential Medal of Freedom. So when they call you on a matter, you change the rest of your schedule for the day. But it does give you an appreciation of the work of the Joint Center, and I came today not only to receive an award from you, but to thank you and to encourage you, because we need you now more than ever. So I think tonight, they can clap for that. Tonight is really about not missing this moment. You see, I am connected to Louis E. Miller because he played a significant role in the selection of Thurgood Marshall for the Supreme Court in advising him to Presidents Johnson and Kennedy during the critical points of the 1960s. Thurgood Marshall is the reason that I went to Howard University for undergrad and for law school. So I do feel connectivity to the person for whom this award is named. But I also feel connectivity to the Joint Center because this is really you all's moment. The Joint Center, since its founding in 1970, has been committed to a notion of taking advantage of all of America's talent, particularly the talent of people of color, and not leaving them behind. So think of the arguments that have been advanced since 1970, all of the intellectual property and the intellectual capital that the Joint Center has been doing that really has not received the amount of attention, I believe, by mainstream elected officials in terms of its implementation. Because when you think of the work of the Joint Center, you actually think that it really is more moral-based than it is based in economic realities that are facing the country. Well, guess what? The world has caught up with the work of the Joint Center. You know, in December of last year, Tom Friedman flew to Atlanta, and he wanted to fly to Atlanta because he wanted to see if all of these things that we were doing in Atlanta were true. When I got elected mayor of the city of Atlanta, we had $7.4 million in the bank in a city that had a budget of $1.6 billion. I've grown the cash reserves in the city of Atlanta, working with my team, from $7.4 million to $100 million. I've added 500 police officers to the Atlanta Police Department. We had a $1.5 billion unfunded pension, working with every single union in the city of Atlanta, working with every single council member. We reformed the entire pension system, and we're going to be able to pay that $1.5 billion liability. We've balanced two budgets, and we've done it all without raising taxes in the city of Atlanta. But we didn't do it with a mean heart. We didn't do it by criticizing or condemning working people. We didn't do it by trying to break the backs of unions. We didn't do it by campaigning against folk. We did it by sitting down at the table and having a conversation and just saying that we can't maintain the current fiscal model that we have right now. And the only thing that is resulting from our failure to deal with our problems is that we have laid off more than 1,800 employees because we can't pay our bills. Now, so balancing a budget isn't about being tough, it's about actually having a heart for people. And making sure that the pension liability is funded isn't about a bumper sticker or a headline or union busting. It's about making sure that when that city worker goes to cash that check in 40 and 50 and 60 years, they get 100 cents on the dollar, not 50 cents on the dollar. If you think of the things that I'm telling you right now, you all already know it because the Joint Center has been there. But see, the world is actually catching up with you all because right now we have $200 billion in unfunded pension liabilities throughout the United States of America, and we need to address it. And to the extent that there are models at the local, state, and federal level that do so in a humane and thoughtful way, and you pass them with 15-0 vote, a unanimous vote of the city council, I think it creates a model and that it makes us all so much better. Now, Tom Friedman wrote a great article, and then he did a book called That Used to Be Us, which is a New York Times bestseller, and he focused on another issue that I think is also consistent with Joint Center work. And the argument that he makes is real clear. He says that the future of the world has to do with the expansion of the markets. And the United States' failure to develop its human capital, the skills of our people, kids in Washington and Philadelphia and Atlanta and Detroit and Los Angeles and Newark and New York, and the failure to develop Latino kids, and the failure to develop rural kids, is weakening the United States of America because our fiscal model can no longer carry all of those individuals. So you are now hurting the United States of America because if those individuals were appropriately trained, they would add about $400 billion in economic productivity to the United States of America, and that adds up to about $4 trillion over the next 10 years, which happens to be about the amount of money that the Republicans and the Democrats have been trying to resolve regarding to the debt and deficit. So by focusing on working people, by focusing on the work that's been done by the Joint Center, we can actually begin to develop our own people, make our country stronger, and also meet our economic and human needs. I love Tom Friedman, I'm a fan. I've seen 4 articles on that in the Joint Center in the last 8 years, focusing on the economic productivity of humans. The United States today is about 24% of the world's GDP. If China and India and Russia continue to rise, there will be a point in time in the future where the United States percentage of the world's GDP goes down to about 17 or 18%. When you look at the unemployment rate right now, if our people were skilled enough to take the jobs that are available, our unemployment would be at an effective rate of about 6 to 5.5%. We don't have qualified individuals to fill the jobs at the high end, and then we have a wrong-minded immigration policy that's prohibiting people from coming in and contributing to the vitality of the country. All of these are conversations that the Joint Center has been talking about for years, but there needs to be greater connectivity between the Joint Center's intellectual power and elected officials who are doing the job every single day. When I met with the board today, I said, Michael Hancock in Denver needs to know what the Joint Center can do for him. Kamala Harris, who's an extraordinary attorney general in California, I believe her future's unlimited, needs to know what the Joint Center can do for her. Cory Booker, who's doing an amazing job in Newark, needs to know the same thing. Anthony Fox, who's doing an incredible job in Charlotte, needs to know the same thing. What I'm here to tell you all is that there is extraordinary connectivity that needs to be leveraged to expand the wisdom of the Joint Center so that all of the knowledge that you are developing is being pushed out. Chairwoman Marshall talked to me about a Sylvia Russell, who's her counterpart in Georgia. At 7:52 a.m. this morning, Sylvia Russell had already texted me about Mrs. Marshall before I ever walked into the board meeting. The level of connectivity that is going on is something that needs to be exploited at all times. So the Joint Center can't be a museum. It has to be the present, the past, and the future, all of those things at the exact same time. I know that the intellectual power is there. I know that the intellectualist capital is there, but we have to get on with it because we are coming out of the worst economy we've had in 80 years, and we candidly have never needed you more for the argument. Because I'm here to tell you, the other side in this debate, and that is those think tanks that believe that more exclusionary policies that continue to contribute to extraordinarily uneven wealth distribution have a massive megaphone that they use to push forth bad information on a constant basis. And people who are in positions like me have to be used to push forth information that counters those arguments. Because you all know, because you all know, as the old folks say, you can't beat something with nothing. So to that young mayor, that young state representative, that young state senator that has a heart for people, but who hasn't quite matured enough to have the policy positions that express what they feel in their heart, that something is wrong, that we ought to protect the least of these, that we ought to train up every single young person we can so that they have the same ladder of success that we have. The other side's always talking about pulling up your bootstraps and climbing the ladder of success. And our side says that success is really to climb a ladder with one hand so you can use the other hand to pull somebody up on the same ladder. The biggest debate in 100 years in this country is getting ready to occur. And it's going to be around our upcoming election. The decision couldn't be more stark. And I'm here to tell you, folks, I want us to have an absolute ball tonight. But I need us to understand that in the coming days and weeks ahead, that we need to have passion. And we need to stop being so polite about being right. I watched some of our friends on the far right extremes, and they just love arguing and being as wrong as the day is long. I watched a man on Meet the Press last Sunday that I've appeared on quite a few times say that women earn as much money as men and hold his ground. I mean, this is despite what the census says, what the federal government says, what the Lilly Ledbetter Act says. And this guy turns around and is confronting Rachel Maddow on national television arguing that women earn as much money as men and starts making up all of these variables such as life choices and all of the rest. If you go position by position, women are not paid as well as men, period. Winston Churchill says, "Worry about the man or woman that smiles when they fight." That's where we are, folks. We are generally right on policy. We're generally right on position. But my dad tells me all of the time that passion is the enemy of fatigue. And a passionate person can beat an intellectual person who won't do the work 9 times out of 10. So I don't want y'all to say that we thought Kasim was a happy fellow and we brought him up here to Washington and he was a real... Guy was a real downer, you know? Clearly, after you've seen my high top fade, you all know I can party and I can have a good time too. But we can't miss this moment. And we can't stop supporting an organization that is important as the Joint Center. But we've got to have this generational connectivity. Because the generation that's coming behind us for all of the bad things that said about Generation X and Y and all of the rest does things that my generation never did. I watch young women and men that work at the law firm that I used to work at where the starting salary is $145,000 a year. I've seen a top of her class graduate walk into a partner's office and say, hey, you know what? I'm not working after 5:30 because I'm going to go and teach some kids in Southwest Atlanta to read. And if it means that you need to fire me, I'm prepared for you to fire me. I never. Young ladies in the office typing up a brief with a candle lit and the lights off. But wave to me when she's leaving on her way home. There's something special about this generation, though. I mean, it tickled me so much, I decided to follow and see that she actually read to these kids. And, you know what I mean? You know, I think I'm pretty slick, too. I'm going to go and check this out. But you know what? She was. And then one day, I remember that she had one of the children that she tutors that she wanted to meet me. And I wasn't mayor then. I was a state senator. And we went downstairs in One Atlantic Center in the city of Atlanta, and she had the little girl that she tutors. Her mom dropped her off in a car that didn't appear to work well or meet environmental standards. She did. But the little girl got out of the car, and I was standing next to the associate, and we were in a building that has the revolving door. And the little girl walked up to the building and just stood and looked at the revolving door. The mom drove off. And the little girl just stared at us, and we were on the other side of the glass in the lobby. And we were wondering, what's wrong? I said, what's going on? And the little girl wouldn't come in. And then we pushed through the revolving door, the kind that makes that big whooshing sound. And we went out and realized that the little girl didn't know how to use the revolving door because she hadn't seen one or experienced it. That's what's at stake here. I watched her eyes as we went through it and turned around when she got nervous, wondering whether she was going to be able to get out. Don't ever fail to connect the work that you do here with the life outcome. Because when we don't stand up for folks, when we don't fight, when we don't make the arguments, when we don't make the case, real people get hurt. Real people's lives get changed. Real people have opportunities taken from them in a country that could give them so easily. On October 17th, I set not far from here, on the day that we dedicated the Martin Luther King Memorial. And after that, the president and the first lady invited everybody back to the White House. It was one of the most incredible days I've ever had in my life, let alone as mayor of the city. I mean, it looked like an episode of Roots. People all up in the White House. I mean, they were like down there, over there. Presidents taking pictures like this. You know. And so a group of us we're leaving the east exit of the White House and with Ambassador Andrew Young. And Ambassador Andrew Young was, you know, when he says Martin, I mean, he's not talking about the guy at the cleaners. I mean, he's talking about, you know, he says President Kennedy. I mean, he means like President Kennedy. And so he was telling us about how he had gotten here. And you know, we were trying to do some intellectual conversation with him. What was the strategy? What were you thinking? What was the fear at the moment? You know, everybody's trying to like outsmart each other. And he looked at me and he looked at us. Martin Luther King III was behind him. And with tears rolling down his aging face, he said, wasn't what happened at all. He said, we tried and we made mistakes all of the time. But we did know that fundamentally we were right, and we were willing to sacrifice whatever it took for what we were doing. He said, we had a plan. We worked our plan, and then he laughed a little bit. He said, and wouldn't you know it, we changed the world. And I believe tonight that that's appropriate counsel from one of the greatest Americans, in my judgment, to ever live. Think about that advice. Things don't always turn out all right. Things aren't always easy. Be fearless. Have a plan. When the plan fails, try again. Stick to your plan. And before you know it, you just might change the world. God bless you.